Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light upon earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all. Conquering fear, our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Jesus, hope of the nations. Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are.
Welcome to Twickenham. We're glad to have you here. Vickery's are glad to be back. We were gone last week to finish up some business in Atlanta. Got our house sold, closed. It's no longer ours. And boy, we missed you guys. We got to go to church with Mom and Dad last week, which was nice, but we missed being here. And I do want just to note that I have socks on today. So, but if you don't, it's okay. We're very ecumenical here. You can wear socks or not. So, if you're visiting with us, glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. I know that there's some guests here this morning who are traveling. So you're on the road, and God bless you for stopping in and worshiping with us this morning. We're glad you're here. Our prayers are that you have a safe arrival at your journey and that something wonderful happens on the way. Other folks that I've met this morning are from town, and if you're looking for a church home, we would love to sit down and visit with you about Twickenham. We don't have all the answers, but we do know some of the questions, and maybe you know some others, so we can sit down and have a good conversation. We'd love to talk with you about maybe making Twickenham your home. And of course, if you're a member, always glad you are here. Let's go ahead and stand together, please, and we're going to hear a quick scripture here from Psalm 113 and continue with our worship. Really glad you're here. We just pray you'll be blessed today by our time together. Hear the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forever. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Let's praise him together.
Let the earth and heavens rejoice,
for the Lord our God reigns.
Every child of God lift your voice,
for the Lord our God reigns. Jesus Emmanuel, he has set us free. Hopeless souls redeemed to tell, for the Lord our God reigns. For the Lord our God reigns.
Every heart be filled with life,
for the Lord our God reigns.
All the hopeless dance with delight,
for the Lord our God reigns. Jesus Emmanuel,
Dear God, we come to you now in reverence and humility, but also in courage and in full faith that you are here in this place, hearing this prayer at this moment, and we thank you for your presence. Father, you alone are holy, righteous, just, and worthy of all of our praise. You are love, and you are truth, and you are the source of our faith and our forgiveness. We are grateful for all you have done and are doing in and through this congregation of believers, and we ask you in faith for even more opportunities to bless and to serve, to lead and disciple, to worship you and give to others. And as you avail those new opportunities, Lord, we ask that you equip us not just with considerations of the temporary, but Father, rather with a perspective of your eternal wisdom. Help us with the task of aligning the actions and thoughts of our daily lives with the timeless truths of you've provided us in your holy and errant scripture. Father, as we live in a society with such chaos, carnage, and calamity, we ask that you guide us with a firm resolve of the principles you've provided to us in the Bible. They're always right, they're always relevant, and they will never change. God, we have many needs, and we continuously claim our dependence on you for all of them. For those who are anxious or in doubt, offer them your peace and the beauty of a confidence in you. For those who are lonely, offer them the joy and companionship of your ever-present Holy Spirit. For those who are ill or in pain, offer them healing or a renewed ability to persevere in suffering. For those who have guilt and shame, offer them the freedom, purity, and innocence of believing in you as Lord, your Son Jesus as Savior, and the Holy Spirit as Counselor. In specific to our family here, Father, we lift up the White family as they travel back to New York with hope of a successful surgery. Glenn Laird and others as they recover from respective surgeries. Unborn babies and their expectant mothers, including Ada, Hildy, Stephanie, Amy, Kelsey, and Kathy. Upcoming weddings for Lacey and Kyle, Elizabeth and James, and Caitlin and George. God, as we add more elders to our church body, we rely on you to equip them as they pray and study your word to better guide the people of this congregation towards a life of service, discipleship, stewardship, and salvation, and towards our core beliefs and values. We pray for the upcoming once-a-year adventure of Camp Nayati, for the counselors and kids, their safety and care, but more so, Father, that more would come to know you as their personal Lord and Savior. God, we thank you for Jesus, your Son. We thank you for the perfect example he gave us through his life of service. And we ask you would breathe in us an unquenchable thirst for more of him in our life. As we abide in you, we know you will produce much good fruit through us. In Jesus' name we pray and we believe. Amen.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive
in our acts of
rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ.
One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ. And to this we give our lives, to see
gospel reasons. Perhaps one of the most vivid portrayals of the gospel was given by the inspired hand of Paul in the first half of Romans 5. And there he will say this: "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely will one die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have been justified by his blood, much more shall be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, having been reconciled, shall be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation." 1 Corinthians 11 tells us that we gather together to partake of the Lord's Supper, proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. And Romans 5 reminds us of what we are to proclaim. You see, the truth of Romans 5 is that once we were enemies of God, but because of what Christ did that Friday, now we are reconciled. Once an enemy of God, now I find peace with God through my Lord Jesus Christ. Once we were all objects of his wrath. But because of what happened on the cross that day, wrath is gone. And in its place, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. We are all ungodly sinners. But praise be to God that because of that Friday, we are made righteous. We are weak. And yet, we take this supper, and as we do so, we proclaim that we now have a hope so strong that we can rejoice in our sufferings. It is all true. We were enemies of God. We were objects of his wrath. We are an ungodly people. We are weak. We are sinners. But praise be to God that in his mercy, God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And as we partake of the bread and the wine, we proclaim the death of Christ on the cross and the magnificent love of God for us. Father, as we partake of the bread today, we thank you for the gospel truth that it reminds us of. That your great and glorious Son, though we were weak, though we were sinners, though we were ungodly, showed his love for us, and that on that day he gave himself for us, that we might have your love poured into our hearts. In Christ's name we pray it. Amen.
For a world of lost sinners was slain.
partake of this cup, which reminds us of the blood of Christ shed that day, we do so remembering that it is that blood that has justified us, that has turned away your wrath and has made us righteous. And for that, Father, for that deep gospel truth, we thank you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
To that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine,
glory in the Amen. Be seated, please. I'm laughing because I like to be up here as soon as the song is over. Because, you know, I used to work in radio, and dead air is like the anathema. And that song would never end. I couldn't figure out when to come up. So I walked over in front of Lincoln and was going. So. Hey, quick program note here. Tonight is, we're springing tonight, right? The spring is tonight. Are we springing up or springing down? Up here or down there?
Up here.
We're up here tonight. Good, I like that better, but I don't always get to say. So, spring tonight. I've been to, I think this is maybe my third spring. This is the first one that I get to be a part of. I'm going to do some reflections out of Isaiah 53 tonight. So come and join us. It's an instrumental service. We'll have some folks playing and singing, and we'll all sing together and worship together. And we'll be looking at Isaiah 53 tonight. 5 o'clock? 5 o'clock, great. Wednesday night, we resume. I get to resume, and thanks to Steve for covering for me last week, but we get to resume our dinner in Devo at, that's 5:30? Or 5? 5:30. I'm new here, so I don't know when everything is. It's 5:30 Wednesday night. We're going to pick up with our odd characters and strange stories from the Old Testament, so we'll have a great time Wednesday night. And our Ecuador team is back. Are you? Can I know a lot of those guys are downstairs. If you were on the Ecuador team, would you just stand up for a second so we can see that the Lord answered our prayers and you are safe? Welcome back. Welcome back. All right. Good, good. Okay, well, why don't you look in Acts chapter 8 with me? Acts chapter 8 is where we'll be this morning. There is a great moment in Ray Bradbury's classic novel, Fahrenheit 451. The novel tells the story of a man named Guy Montag, and it's this dystopian America many, many years into the future. And in Montag's world, all books are banned. When they're discovered, they're burned, and the houses in which they're discovered are burned, and sometimes the people who had the books. And Montag is one of the firemen, and in his world, firemen don't put out fires, they start them. They go burn the books. Well, Montag one day sees a book, and before it's burned, he steals it. And he wonders, he's been wondering why books are so dangerous, and so he gets one and he begins to read it. And he just falls in love with the worlds that books make available to him. Well, of course, his crime is discovered. And so he flees the city for the forest, and there he finds the book people, people who have committed books to memory, and they hope that one day when the world regains its senses that they can rewrite all the classics. A character named Granger is the leader of the book people, and he asks Montag, "Have you read anything?" And Montag says, yes, I've read part of the book of Ecclesiastes. And then Granger, the leader, turns to another character named the Reverend, and he says, do we have a book of Ecclesiastes? And the Reverend says, one, a man named Harris in Youngstown. Granger turns back to Montag, and he says, walk carefully, guard your health, because if anything should happen to Harris, you are the book of Ecclesiastes. See how important you have become in the last minute? Okay, our text, Acts chapter 8. By the way, you students, how's that summer reading coming? We're doing that? I don't know if Fahrenheit 451 is on your list, but it should be. Our text this morning, Acts chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. We'll hear this and then we'll pray. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him, but Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. Let's pray. Strong God of love, Your son Jesus told us that his church would be persecuted as he was persecuted. We pray for people now in countries far away from here who are being silenced with bullets and fire. We pray for their safety. We pray for their courage. And if we should suffer for righteousness' sake, we pray that you would save us from self-righteousness and fill us with your Spirit, that we might show the courage and maintain the convictions of the faithful. Give us grace to pray for our enemies and to forgive them, even as you have forgiven us, through Jesus Christ, who was crucified but is risen, and whom we praise forever. Amen. If you detect a correspondence between the text that we've just heard a moment ago, and things that are going on in our world, I will remind you that we're in a series centered in the book of Acts. When we were last together, we looked at chapter 7, and today we're looking at chapter 8. The reason we're looking at chapter 8 is because it follows chapter 7. So if this text seems particularly relevant, given what's happening to Christians around the world and some of the antagonism you may be feeling toward Christianity within our own country, then you may express your appreciation to the author of this text. His ability to provide a timely word is remarkable. Luke begins with these words: on that day, a great persecution broke out. That would be the day that a man named Stephen, a member of the Jerusalem church, was murdered for preaching an unpopular sermon. That event, the murder of Stephen and the subsequent persecution, had to be shocking if you were a Christian living in Jerusalem at that time. Because all through Acts, Luke has been telling us, and I've mentioned this to you already, that Luke's been telling us that the church was just experiencing phenomenal growth and phenomenal popularity. In chapter 2, verse 41, about 3,000 were added to their number. In chapter 2, verse 47, the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Chapter 4, the number of men grew to about 5,000. Chapter 5, verse 14, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. So they're growing by leaps and bounds numerically, and not only were they growing in number, but the church was getting just upvoted like crazy. In chapter 2, verse 47, they enjoyed the favor of all the people. In chapter 5, verse 13, they were highly regarded by the people. If the Twickenham church scored that level of popularity, we'd be trending on all social networks. So it had to be just whiplash when suddenly this great persecution broke out. And you got to wonder, why did that happen? Why did all of a sudden, with all this popularity, did the church start being persecuted? I think there are two or three different reasons. One of them is that despite the popularity that the church enjoyed with the common people, the elite had been consistently opposed to the church. The Jewish leaders had tried on at least three occasions to silence the message that the apostles were teaching, or to imprison or silence the apostles. So the common people were sort of in with the church and liked it a lot, but there were the leaders that were very much against it. Some influential people were opposed to it. I think a second reason is the all too familiar fickle factor. You know, crowds one day are all for the coach, and then the next day they're putting for sale signs in his yard, right? That happens. The days before Jesus was crucified, the crowds in Jerusalem were shouting, "Hosanna, Lord save." Days later, they were shouting, "Crucify." They turned on a dime, or in those days, a denarius. But they can get really, really ugly. A third possibility is that, and this one I think has some merit to it, Stephen's death. When Stephen preached that unpopular sermon and they dragged him out of the city and crushed him to death with rocks, I think Stephen's death told the enemies of the church that the church was touchable. The church was vulnerable. I think to that point they didn't think they could do anything because there were so many miracles going on and so much popularity. But when they killed Stephen, I think the reasoning went something like this: if one man can be silenced with a few stones, then a legion can be silenced with a lot of stones. Persecution just sort of became a math problem after that. You just needed more rocks. So on the day Stephen was murdered, Luke says, a great persecution broke out against the church. Now, we've talked before. I told you when you read the Bible, make a movie in your head, right? Because that kind of helps you visualize what's going on. When you read those words, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, what do you see in your head? You see enraged citizens wielding pitchforks and torches, storming a cathedral while the Christians huddle inside. Well, the only thing close to a cathedral in Jerusalem was the temple, and that was not a Christian facility. When Luke tells us in verse 3 that a man named Saul began to destroy the church, and I've seen this before in my head, and I had to get rid of this image because it was a bad one, but I saw Paul pushing down the plunger on a detonator and laughing maniacally as the church building blew up. That's not how it happened. Luke says that when Saul wanted to destroy the church, and the word he uses there expresses brutal, sadistic cruelty. When he wanted to brutally, sadistically, and cruelly destroy the church, Luke says he had to go house to house to do it. That's because the church was not a location on a map. It was located wherever Christians lived, house to house. That sounds like Saul was forced to wage a kind of urban warfare against an insurgency that was dispersed among the civilian population of Jerusalem. It sounds that way because that's the way it was. And that's a thing that I think challenges us just a little bit. Challenges me. We have come to associate the concept of church with a particular time and location. The time is Sunday and Wednesday, if you really mean it, and the place is the church building. I think there is this sort of assumption we make that church is a place and a time, and that way of thinking can lead to some very incorrect conclusions. In our current climate, in this culture, it actually has the power to threaten our constitutional rights. Now, I don't do politics from the pulpit, okay? I don't do politics from the pulpit. But I do want to recognize that I think there's some things going on. Recently, Wisconsin Senator Tammy Baldwin said that the First Amendment to the Constitution applied only to institutions of faith, not to the individuals who hold the faith. In other words, you can have your religion as long as it's inside the four walls of your church building, your synagogue, or your mosque. But beyond that, you need to set aside any religious convictions, especially if they conflict with Caesar, especially if they go against the grain of the culture. You can't bring your faith into the public square. When we think of church as this and now, our culture begins to think of church as this building, this location, and this time. And they want to say to us, well, you can say what you want to say in there, but when you get out there, you got to be quiet. That springs from a misconception about what church is. But second, there's a much more immediate threat, and that's that we begin to treat our faith like an appointment. Because like on Sunday, between 9 a.m. and 11:15, I have to be at 7500 Whitesburg Drive for my appointment with God. That's where God lives. God can be conveniently scheduled so as to avoid unnecessary conflicts. Monday through Saturday, we can pursue our jobs, maintain our responsibilities, enjoy our recreations. We can dally with our temptations. We can escape through our diversions. Then come Sunday, come the Lord's Day, we can attend to spiritual matters. And so the first problem with that way of thinking is that God gets cozied or waved or Google Calendared or whichever app you use to keep up with your schedule. We schedule God. But the way I understand it, God is not a time on the calendar. God is above all of that. God's for everywhere and all the time. There's a third problem that comes when we think of church as a location or a time. We begin to limit the idea of church. When we limit the idea of church to one day a week, we begin to define Christianity almost exclusively by what happens on that day. And since worship is the main event on Sunday, being a Christian begins to be largely defined by the way in which that main event is experienced. My identity as a member of the church begins to be shaped only by what happens the 1 or 2 hours I have scheduled for God that one day a week. And so what happens in those 1 or 2 hours, that one day a week, takes on enormous importance. Not only do I begin to define myself by what happens in those 1 or 2 hours, that one day a week, but I begin to measure the faith of others based on what they do on Sunday mornings. If they do things the way my church does them, they're good Christians. If they do things differently, they may not even be Christians at all. Never mind, they may spend the rest of the week, Monday through Saturday, earnestly loving their neighbors as themselves, or ceaselessly praying or denying themselves, taking up their crosses and following Christ. If you think I'm exaggerating that, then ask yourself this question: why do some people leave one church and go look for another? Why do some people leave one church and go look for another? Is it because the Monday through Saturday lives of the people in their old church are not authentic and don't reflect the values articulated in the gospel? Or is it because what happens during 1 hour of the week doesn't fit their definition of what it means to be a Christian? And your experience could be different than mine, okay? I'm not laying down a rule here. I'm just saying my experience is that often the reason people leave a church and go look for another one is because they don't like what happens on Sunday, not because they're looking for a more authentic Monday through Saturday church. And for what it's worth, what do you think unbelievers pay more attention to? What we do here on Sunday morning, or how we live our lives the rest of the week? My hunch is they pay more attention to who we are Monday through Saturday than who we are on Sunday. The church Saul tried to destroy in Acts 8 was indestructible, in part, not the only reason, but in part because it was more like a divine insurgency than an ecclesiastical garrison. That's also why it was so effective. Instead of becoming this ginormous religious warehouse open for business one day a week, it became a 7-day-a-week door-to-door distributor of good news. Church wasn't where Christians met. It was how Christians lived. It wasn't limited to or defined by what happened 1 hour a week, but who those people were 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, which may help explain why this effort to shut down the church succeeded in having exactly the opposite effect. Luke tells us that when the persecution broke out, all but the 12 apostles were scattered throughout Judea in Samaria, which incidentally is exactly what Jesus told them was going to happen back in Acts chapter 1. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. It begins to happen right here. They begin to be his witnesses in Judea and Samaria. So if all but the 12 apostles were scattered, how many was that? Well, the last time Luke counted heads was in Acts chapter 4. And he said the number of men grew to about 5,000. So assuming their gender demographics were roughly equivalent to ours, somewhere in the range of at least 10,000 Christians had to get out of Dodge. 10,000 of them scattered. And Luke says that when they did, and the translations here use an unfortunate word, they preached the word wherever they went, which makes it sound like they had 10,000 preachers. Really, what they did was tell the story of who Jesus was and what he had done. It's not like all 10,000 of them stood up in a pulpit and said, let's all look in Acts chapter 8 and let me tell you this sermon. What they did was say, hey, have you heard of this guy Jesus? Let me tell you what happened to me. They told the story of what happened to him. When I was a kid, my brother and I were playing with fire one day. We played with fire a lot of days, but on this particular day, we were playing with fire in a dry field behind our house. Playing's really not the right term because we had a mission. We were trying to burn out a bee's nest. And since you either have children or have been a child, you kind of know where this is going. The fire spread well beyond what we intended. It spread for two reasons. The field was, as I said, dry, painfully dry, Sahara Desert dry, dry like a two-week-old dead lizard in your driveway in July, dry, really dry field. And then the second reason it spread is because once we realized it was getting out of hand, we took our shirts off and we began beating the fire, which had the effect of spreading the flames further and further and further. A couple of our buddies came. We finally got the fire put out. And then this was what we told our dad. A UFO landed in the field. And he did not believe it. And he introduced us to a new definition for hot spot. So anyway, in those early days at the inception, when the church was a 24/7 relationship rather than a one-day-a-week appointment with God, when the church was a people rather than a place, when church work was the work the people of the church did, nobody ever said, don't try this at home. Because the home and the school and the job and the neighborhood were exactly where church was supposed to be tried. And because of that, they grew even when someone tried violently to stop them. Think of Paul, or Saul at that time of Tarsus, the persecutor, as a 10-year-old boy taking his shirt off, beating a flame in a field. And every time he does, the sparks spread, and they start a new fire somewhere else. That's what happened then. Now, is there anything about that story that sounds familiar? A fledgling movement begins to gather momentum. People are being drawn to a message. Lives are being changed, but opposition arises. Violence erupts. The messenger is murdered. Just when all hope seems lost, the very thing that seemed to be the end of the movement catalyzes an even greater reaction. That's the Jesus story. That's the story of his church in Acts 8. That can be your story and mine. Three quick takeaways. Number one, do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. I'm talking to a lot of believers these days, and they tell me, and I feel it too, we are feeling a new and more aggressive cultural antagonism. Let's put it in perspective. Nobody's trying to silence us with bullets or fire right now. Okay, that's happening in other parts of the world where Christians really are dying. But we are feeling some pressure, unlike we have felt in my lifetime. The Jeremiahs among us, our most pessimistic prognosticators, envision forced renunciation of our faith and even imprisonment in the near future. My sense is that those possibilities are quite remote, probably not realistic. But it is the case that we do not now enjoy the favor of all the people. And as this passage demonstrates, crowds can turn ugly very quickly. But what happens every time someone or some group tries to destroy the church, tries to silence the church, what happens every time? The church of Christ flourishes. Our most expansive growth, our most faithful witness, has always come in a season of opposition. In some ways, we can embrace these days with enthusiasm, even with excitement, because these are the kinds of times when God demonstrates his power. So do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. Second, if yours is a weekend faith, not a way of life, it is time for you to repent. And I choose that term intentionally. It is time to change. There was a time in our recent past when you could hold on loosely to your faith. Most everybody you encountered believed in God. They had a functioning biblical literacy. They were favorably disposed toward the church. They generally embraced Judeo-Christian values. Those days are over. The cultural supports for Christianity have been kicked out from under us. If your faith is going to survive in this culture, it cannot be a weekend faith. It has got to be a way of life. You are going to encounter problems in your life that a weekend faith cannot handle. You are going to encounter obstacles and struggles and pains and problems that a weekend faith will not be able to handle. You got to have faith that's a way of life. Church can no longer be an appointment on the calendar or a MapQuest address. It's got to be who you are every day of the week, everywhere you go. Last thing. I don't think we're ever going to live in a Fahrenheit 451 world where books are burned and the people who read them are imprisoned. But we are already living in a world where you are the gospel. There was a time when if we had a great Sunday morning event on a regular basis, people would come. There was a time when attractional Christianity worked. We could wait for them to come to us. But those days are over. We are now going to go to them and tell them about Jesus. And that's a good thing, because that's how it all started. God came to us in the person of Jesus and told us about his love and a way to receive it. And now he is telling us to go to them. We get to be the gospel. We already are. So that's the challenge that I want to give you this morning. That's the reassurance that I want to give you this morning. If you are not a Christian, I want you to listen to me. If you are not a Christian and you know what you need to do and you're ready to do it, you think there's something to this, then why would you wait another day to go ahead and give your life to Jesus Christ right now? We will stop everything we're doing and we'll assist you in being baptized and receiving his Spirit and his forgiveness. You come down front when we sing this next song, we'll help you with that. If you are not a Christian, but you're not sure and you're not ready for that, can we talk about it reasonably? We're not going to force anything on you, but we would love to sit down, hear your questions. Let us ask some questions together and show you what we believe about it. You can see whether it's true or not. If you are a Christian, but you know in your heart that yours is a weekend faith, will you use this next song that we're singing to recommit yourself to living a faith that's a way of life? It may be that you want to come down here and tell us about that, that you want to say to this group of people, I want to commit to a way of life faith, not a weekend faith, and I want you to hold me accountable for that. It may be that you need to do that. It may be that you're somebody that is really struggling right now. The stuff that you brought with you this morning really didn't have anything to do with this sermon. You got some problems in your life. You got some discouragement. You've had some disappointments. You've gotten some really bad news. And you don't know what you're going to do. Can I just tell you that there are people here who would embrace you and love you, and we would stop everything we're doing and pray for you. If you fall into any one of those categories and you need us, come down front and tell us about it. We'll help you with it. Let's stand. Let's sing together.
Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's
Susan Pryor's come forward this morning, and I'm so thankful that she did. She's got a family member, her father-in-law, that's really struggling with dementia right now. I have heard a lot of that since Lisa and I've been here at Twickenham. We've got some of that in our family too. And it's a new thing for us, and it's just phenomenal, the pressure and the complication that creates. I know a lot of people in this room understand that. Well, Susan's come and asked us, would you just pray for me and for our family while we struggle with that? So we're going to do that. I want to ask you to stand. Let's stand behind her. You may want to come down here and be with her. I think that would be a great thing. And we're going to pray that God will be with her. All right? Father, we're thankful for Susan's courage to come forward this morning and just say, I need your help. And here we are to ask you. We want to be there for her. We want to ask you to be there. We can be the hands and the shoulders to lean on and the feet to go and the mouths to say the encouraging words. But God, the power is going to come from you. And so we want to ask you to bless her. Give her wisdom to know how to respond and how to be, and give her family the wisdom to make the right decisions about the care for her father-in-law. Help her know how to be there for her husband and her children and her mother-in-law and her father-in-law. Give the whole family, God, just this unexplainable spiritual strength to stand up under that struggle and bless them in that. God, we stand with them and we stand with Susan, and we ask you to bless her and help this family with your strength and your power. We lift this family up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you, Stephen. I think you got some announcements.
Jody, thanks for just an incredible challenge, and may we truly be a people rather than a place. Just a few announcements before we close this morning. As Jody mentioned, the spring is tonight at 5 o'clock here in the auditorium. I just wanted to add to that, for ages 0 to 5, we do have babysitting that will be provided, or kids sitting if they're not a baby. Dinner and Devo Wednesday night, 5:45. The menu is poppy seed chicken. We have a special treat this Wednesday night in that the Summer Christian Camp kids will be performing. We expect quite a few visitors, so be sure and get your tickets for that. There's a wedding shower today honoring Lacey Hartzell and her fiancé, Kyle Erickson. That's from 1:30 to 3 o'clock in the Mercy Building. Lacey and Kyle are registered at Bed Bath & Beyond, Target, and Anthropology. If you're going to Camp Nayati, today is the last day to sign up as a camper, and that includes everyone from kindergarten, leaving kindergarten, and to fifth grade. Camp will start this Friday and goes through next Monday, the 20th. If you are a teen or an adult counselor and want to be a part of that, you have till Wednesday to register. Forms are available in the gym lobby. We have installed a new Wi-Fi network, sent out an email earlier this week with the passwords. Hopefully you have been able to jump on that. If you have any questions about that or any issues, let me know. I know there's going to be a few kinks to work out as we go through this, but hopefully we'll have a much more stable network in the coming weeks and months. At this moment, Walton Harless, one of our shepherds, has a special announcement.
Just wanted to take a moment and provide an update to the status of the addition of elders to the Twickenham Church. As you know, this process has been going on since January, and it culminated three weeks ago when we put before the congregation the name of 6 men, and we asked this congregation to respond in a confirmation ballot. Approximately 200 of you did, and I appreciate that very much, and the results are that each one of these 6 men were overwhelmingly confirmed and endorsed by this congregation, and I'm very thankful. Our original plan was that we would install and bless that group of men this morning. A couple of those men had to be out, and I apologize again to some families. We did not get the word out soon enough that we would not be able to do that this morning. But just as soon as we're able to have them all here at the same time, we want to officially recognize them and ask the Lord's blessing. At this time, though, I would like to, on behalf of the elders, just express my profound appreciation for these men by name. And I'm not going to, I don't want to ask them to stand or embarrass them or exalt them for that matter at this time, but I just want to express my appreciation to Dan Beasley, Tom McKee, Steve Owens, John Perry, to Ken Smith, and to Todd White. You have recognized, we've all recognized, these are godly, faithful men. They are certainly qualified, but also they are uniquely gifted, and I look forward to their taking on this responsibility. I also want to express my appreciation to their good wives, because this is not something that you do by yourself. It affects the entire family, and I appreciate them very much. So I would like to express appreciation to Tammy Beasley, to Christy McKee, to Sandra Owens, to Laura Beth White, to Ken, to Suzanne Smith, and to Michelle Perry. There's also 20 men that you recognized in this congregation that were qualified, and they are qualified, godly men, heart for this congregation, for the work here. I appreciate their putting their names and making themselves available as well. My sincere appreciation. And most of all, our appreciation to God for his provision, for the way that he blesses us. And we continue to pray for his spirit, for his guidance as we seek his face, as we seek his will at this congregation. If you would, at this time, please stand. We're going to have a closing prayer.
Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for today. I thank you for the message that's been given from Jody. And Father, that he's back and his family is safe and that he's here with us, Father. We're thankful for that. And we just pray that you would be with us as we live our daily lives, Father, that we don't just live it on Sunday and we live it every day of our of the week and to be bold and to change our heart, Father, so that we can make those changes and be a light to you and in your kingdom and for your glory, Father. We thank you and we ask this in Jesus' name, amen.